Hello friends, welcome to my third episode of video on requirements engineering and management. In this video, I am going to talk about elicitation and gathering of requirements. Now, the dictionary meaning of elicit is to draw forth or bring out something that is latent or potential or call forth or draw out as information or response. It is already there somewhere, and what we have to do is find it out and take it out. And this connotes a dialogue in which information is drawn out from a party possessing the needed information. In elicitation is basically taking information from people. It is already there, people know it. We will have to just elicit the information from them and record it. And the CMMI version 1.3 defines elicitation as using systematic techniques such as prototypes and structured surveys to proactively identify and document customer and end user needs. This is proactive. That means the person who is trying to elicit requirements must be prepared, and the person should go to the source of information with a prototype or a structured survey, with a questionnaire or whatever it is required to elicit the information. Elicit is not the onus of getting the information is on the person who is asking for information more than the person giving information. This definition too indicates a dialogue between software developers and the customers, albeit use of techniques like prototyping and surveys to draw out the needed information, which puts more responsibility on the person who is eliciting than the person who is providing the information. And dictionary assigns multiple meanings to the term gather. Gathering has many more definitions, not one. One of them is to bring together, gathering as in a group, try to gather a crowd or a group. Another meaning is to pick up or amass as if by harvesting or gathering ideas for the project. Gathering is basically they are all scattered all over and we bring them together at one place. Another one is to effect collection of, as in gather contributions, we collect them. As we can see, the term gather connotes collecting things which are available but are scattered all over the place, maybe places. And most technical documents use elicitation and gathering together, even though they are distinct. The literature that I have seen, most of them, they have used these two terms together, elicitation and gathering of requirements, but not as elicitation of requirements and gathering of requirements. Elicitation is first-hand information collection, this is in my humble opinion, from individuals who are directly concerned with the project using interviews. It is from primary sources. Primary sources as those people who are performing the work. And they include end users, experts, and brainstorming. Gathering is indirect collection of information from sources other than human beings. It is from secondary sources. Secondary sources include documents, existing applications, and standards and guidelines. It can be even observation. Elicitation and gathering of requirements is the precursor for all requirements management activities and engineering activities. This is the precursor, this is the first thing in the REM, requirements engineering and management phase. In some cases, elicitation precedes gathering, and in some cases, gathering precedes elicitation. It depending on the situation, if there is too much document information, the most of the information is in the document, then we gather them first and then go to the individuals for clarifications and building the gaps, bridges in the gaps that are there in the documentation. If the documentation is scanty, then we go to the individuals, gather the information, and then supplement it with the information in the available documentation. It depends on the situation. We collect the following information for establishing requirements. The list of processes within the application boundary, whatever application we are putting it on the computers, that first we apply, establish the boundaries, and then enumerate the processes that are within the application boundary. And then the four attributes for each process has basically four attributes. They are the inputs for the trigger the process, and then the outputs, the deliverables from the process, the transformation of the inputs into outputs, and that is the process of transformation, and finally verification of the both input process, output process, and the results, deliverables. These are the four attributes. And the trigger for the process, the exit point for the process. These are the information we elicit and gather for establishing our requirements. Elicitation of requirements. The techniques for elicitation of requirements are these. Personal interviews, we go to people and interview them, not jot down the notes, capture them into a document, and then get the concurrence from the person whom we have interviewed. Questionnaires, we may not personally go and spend time interviewing, we may simply make a questionnaire and send it to the people who have the information and allow them to fill it up. Customer or market surveys. In some cases, we go to the existing customers and make some survey, especially if we are planning an upgrade of the product. And market surveys, when we are introducing a new product, we go to the market and see the demand and the features that are expected by the prospective customers. Observation, we go to a place, a point of sale and look, or some other such place, and key stand there, observe, note down the details, and establish our requirements. Demonstration of product prototypes and the product itself. We may look at the product or the prototype or design, whatever, to reverse engineer it or re-engineer it or engineer it. Brainstorming, when none of these is available, where the concerned people sit in a room, informal setting, and exercise our brain and jot down the requirements. For in-house projects, business analysts meet the end users and elicit the requirements. When we are developing a project for our organizational use, then we meet the end users. And for outsourced project, when a project is outsourced and we are the people who are developing the product and the principal is a different person, the RFP, requirement, request for proposal, provides high level requirements. The high level requirements may be very, very high. And then the project team studies the RFP requirements and prepares a gap document. What is the gap that need to be bridged before we can establish the requirements? And the gaps are bridged using phone calls, emails, personal interviews, teleconferences, video conferences, or whatever. And then we bridge these gaps. The user requirement specification is now finalized after recording all this. Personal interviews. Personal interviews are the most important and most difficult technique of all, because human beings are capable of providing or dodging or not providing the requirements easily. Therefore, the person who is eliciting requirements needs to be adept at this technique and also be prepared. So first thing in planning, anything if we want to plan, if anything we want to execute, planning precedes that execution. In this, there are people who detest planning and would like to jump in and swim. I would like to remind them of the quote from Abraham Lincoln, who said, "If I am given 6 hours to fell a tree, I would spend the first 4 sharpening the axe." So I think this is a very valuable lesson for all of us. And I advocate planning. Whether you document it or not, it is a different secondary issue, but planning is essential. First of all, identify the resources required. One, to conduct the interviews, and the resources that can provide the necessary information. Then estimate the time required for elicitation of requirement from each individual. Why should we estimate this? You know, when we ask for an appointment from some person, we need to tell that person we need so much time. Give or take, there is a tolerance always. But then we need to indicate them the approximate amount of time available. We cannot tell the individual, I am coming to interview you and I do not know how much time I need. They will be very reluctant. So we need to estimate the time required from each individual that is providing us information. And study the preliminary requirements and understand the domain at hand. First thing is, we have to understand the domain. What is the domain in which we are seeking the information? And prepare questions to be asked from each of these interviews. If we have a preliminary set of questions to be asked of the person, we can always ask supplementary or corollary questions later on. But we should have a set of questions ready to be able to gather information comprehensively. Then record the questions in a template. And specifics to ask for each of the processor, each of the person is, whenever he describes a process, the trigger, which triggers this process, what are the inputs needed for it, outputs needed, to be delivered by that process, and what validations and verifications need to be performed, and any exceptions in these activities. All these we need to gather. Ask that person and get the information. And then we prepare formats and templates to capture information efficiently. We have to prepare the question and also provide for answer space so that we can quickly jot down. Should this be on paper? In these days, using paper for collecting information, I think is obsolete. We take a laptop or a tablet and then capture information in that. We have the necessary software tools. And using them, we can capture the information, but firsthand, we should be ready with the templates and formats. Then fix appointments and conduct the interview efficiently. Conducting interview efficiently is the most critical of all the activities in conducting, gathering, eliciting information from individuals. First thing, to be on time for the appointment. Then ask questions politely, no contradiction, no criticism, no making fun. Draw a rough flowchart to ensure right understanding of the described process and obtain concurrence. When somebody explains something, jotting down notes is not adequate. Draw a flowchart roughly by hand, freehand sketching, and then show it to the person who is providing the information and obtain his or her concurrence. This will be accurate. It will make our act free of errors and defects. In case of ambiguity, sometimes the description may be ambiguous, then describe your own understanding and get it confirmed or clarified. And if essential, fix up appointment for the next round. If the elicitation is either complete or if you want clarifications, once again, if a second round is required, fix up the appointment. And collect the forms being used. Every end user uses certain forms and templates and records. Collect them. How to collect them? You can take a camera and scan them, or take if there are soft copies are available, you can ask the person to email them in your presence, but collect all the forms in whatever form. For each of the data items, there will be data items, ascertain the type of data and maximum possible length of the data item. These two are crucial for designing the application. If the interview needs to be closed for any reason, close it after completing a process, not halfway through a process. This way you will be complete to a logical ending. Capture the information. Record the information in the corresponding template. If feasible, now it is feasible, technology is available, have an audio recording of the conversation. If you are taking a laptop, you can record it. If you are taking a tablet, you can record it. If you are taking a smartphone, you can record it. So have a recording. Video interview is much better. And video interview, you may need a camera and proper capturing, but audio interview is very easy. Audio capturing is very easy. You should do that. And check, using a checklist, the completeness of the interview. Customer and market surveys. This is a technique used extensively in the development of cards, commercial off-the-shelf products, generally from a wide audience. You don't limit it to one or two people, as in the elicitation. You cannot interview 1,000 or 10,000 people, but customer or market survey, especially market survey, can go to thousands. Objectives. First, to obtain information on the latent demand, potential demand, target markets, three things. Latent demand, the demand is there, but nobody is serving it. Potential demand, there can be demand if we advertise it or promote it properly. What are the target markets, demographic division? To prove or disprove a hypothesis, if we say there is some market demand, to disprove it, or if we say there is no demand, disprove it, or if we say there is a demand, prove it. For that, a testing of a hypothesis, we conduct this, use this technique. And to learn a social trend, what are the people going to do? A beautiful scenario is described in a novel called Wheels by Arthur Haley. After making such a social trend survey, the chief designer of the automobile comes up with the quotation, "Ugly is beautiful." What is now considered trendy was once considered ugly. So we may try to test like that. To learn the type of usage of a class of products, how the products are being used. People are ingenious and they put the product to uses which we have never even dreamt of. And targeted sources of information, chief information officers, general public, existing customers, value-added resellers, technical support staff, internal and external consultants, all these are possible sources of information. And what are these types of surveys? Face-to-face. When there are one or two questions, people may stand at the street corner and ask questions. Postal method, we may send an email or an SMS or a WhatsApp message and seek information. Web-based surveys, we put up the forms on the web and ask people to fill up the survey. Questionnaires for surveys. See, survey needs a questionnaire. Usually based on an existing product. Sometimes we may simply ask them to dream up. Use mostly objective questions with multiple choices. If we ask them to describe, the collection and the analysis becomes impossible. So unless it is essential, we use only objective questions and do not use subjective questions. And following aspects are included. Order of importance of the product features, which is the most important, which is less important. We may put 10 priorities, but the order of importance also we take. Most essential features, the customer says, if these features are not present, I will not even look at your product. That are essential. Features that are desirable but not essential. Yeah, you know, we like to have them, but we can make do with it. Motivating features. Motivating is to make job easier, make life easier, or have a make good appeal, or a one-upmanship appeal. Additional features. What additional that they can think of, that we could not think of. Observation. The analyst simply observes the operations while they are taking place and collects the information. Instances, examples, the point of sales in the supermarket or mall, to see what is the rate of arrival, dispatch, what are the problems being faced by the counter clerk. A busy bank teller, how the things are happening and how it can be improved. Guest registration counter in a busy hospital or hotel, how can it be simplified. The online registration reservation system. A customer support person at a help desk. An inquiry assistance counter in a busy public facility, including bus stations, railway stations, airports, government offices, and so on. working machines in the case of real-time software development and any other similar scenario. There can be thousands different scenarios. We use observation in such cases. Demonstration and prototype often used to finalize requirements than to obtain original requirements. That means we do have such an idea, so we build a prototype. But to finalize, we use this. We demonstrate the prototype to experts or end users and then take the additional requirements or improvements or corrections that are needed. Especially useful if the customer is not adapted to the tools used by software professionals. Oftentimes, we develop data flow diagrams, entity relationship models, use case models, and class diagrams. You know, there are many, many picture drawings that we use, and most of the people, they do not understand, especially in commercial business applications. Then prototype is something that they can easily identify and discuss, provide information. The end users look at the prototype and provide feedback on what points, missing features. If there are any missing features that are essential for them, they will tell us. Modifications of the implementation of their requirement to suit their needs. They may be doing it in a specific way and they may not be happy with that. They may say, give us another way of doing it, things. So they will identify that. Wrong implementation of their requirements. If we have not implemented their requirements properly, they will also point out any additional requirements that were not included earlier. They may come up with additional requirements. And in the prototype that we use two types of prototypes, use and discard. In use and discard, we use drafting tools that are available in software or Visio or AutoCAD or whatever. And use and improve. In use and improve, we build the prototype using the final development platform. We only develop the screens and reports with the dummy data and show it. There is no code at the back end except the presentation screens. And then when they give these inputs, we develop this. In this, the argument is that, you know, whatever effort we put in developing the prototype is not wasted. We can make use of at least 70-60% of the effort we put in. In use and discard, all the effort is wasted. So it depends on the situation, depends on the convenience and the expertise of the people that are demonstrating. They can do that. Product demonstrations. Product demonstrations are used when there is already in a product and then we want to upgrade it or build a similar one. Then we take the product, demonstrate it to experts and customers and end users, and then I obtain this information. Additional features needed, feature modification of the existing features, how it can be improved, and deletion of the features when they are not serving the purpose. Brainstorming. Brainstorming is a technique when none of the above techniques can be used, especially in a cost product scenario. No existing product is available to build upon. The stakeholders brainstorm to arrive at the features. Marketing, what they have feedback from the market. Project team, what they can develop. Management, how they would like to have it. Especially the target market and the pricing and the profits, whether it justifies or not, what are the costs involved, they will give their input. Consultants who are experts in the area, they come and give the expertise. Domain experts, if we are building a product in customer relationship management, there may be experts and they will give us their input. We all sit together and in an informal setting, we jot down the requirements and later on analyze and establish them. Gathering of requirements. Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines word gather to mean to pick up or amass as if by harvesting. Or the example is gathering ideas for a project. To scoop up or take up from a resting place. They're there. Nobody is touching them. We take it up. Among others, for using that word as a transitive verb. Gathering of requirements generally connotes taking the information from documents, The documents may be soft copies, hard copies, historical records, or just jotted down slips, anything. Organizational records give information to design tables and databases, number and the types of fields, relation between tables, sizes of tables, records. Documentation, process documentation, processes, procedures, standard operating procedures, checklists. These give us the process details, helps in designing the processes. Organizational records help us to build, design the database. Process documentation helps us to design the processes, conversion processes. And standards and guidelines, most organizations have standards and guidelines. They help us in building the validations, also designing the databases. Customer satisfaction records, surveys, complaints, commendations, these also help us to build the process and also databases. Additional fields may have to be added, additional processes maybe have to be added. Then publications, reports and surveys. There can be an industry report or some other gardeners, foresters, all these people produce many reports, governments produce reports. They all can help us, especially in designing COTS products. Surveys, our own surveys, external surveys, general surveys, we can make use of all of them to design databases and the processes. And the important aspect and the latest thing is agile methodologies, agile projects. Agile methodology places more emphasis on satisfying the customer than on documentation. Wasteful practice, they call it. Whether documentation is wasteful or not is a secondary point, but the primary point is satisfaction of the customer. And they also say co-location of the customer with the development team. Co-location, the customer sits with the development team and keeps clarifying and telling them the process. The customer gives a requirement one day and that is developed in the next week or so. And any interim clarifications they are on hand to provide. But when the product is development is offshored, the developers are sitting 10,000 miles away, the customer is sitting here, and there is a time gap of 10-12 hours between the customer and the development team. How is it managed? The term virtual co-location is used. That means either the development team uses the timings of the customer, or the customer uses the timings of the development team, or they may share. 4 hours they are together, 4 hours they are not together. In that manner, there is virtual co-location, and this is producing results. I am not sure how effective they are, but these are being used. And in agile methodologies, the iteration is usually short. It shall not exceed 4 weeks, unless there are exceptional conditions. Agile methodologies ever that it is not really necessary to elaborately document the requirements. That is, take the requirement, design it then and there, develop the code, test it and hand it over. Why requirement being postponed till the end of the thing? And this is more fully covered in a future video. Elicitation and gathering of requirements in COTS products implementation. This is also happening. There are COTS products that need to be implemented. And during the implementation, there is certain customization required. These products comprise of the best practices culled from the respective industry and cover all functional areas of the selected domain. In most cases, some sort of customization would be necessary in the product as well as the practices. The project requirements for the scenario comprise of the areas of the product which need to be modified to suit the organization. There are certain things that need to be modified and modification is possible. That is what is requirements elicitation and gathering come here. The details thereof for building the layer above the product to meet these needs. Elicitation and gathering, both elicitation and gathering would be useful in the projects implementing COTS product. They may have certain records and documents which we can see and do, and in some cases we may have to simply interview the end users to modify the product by demonstrating the product and seeking their views. This is a fit scenario to capture project requirements by demonstrating the product itself. Here is product itself will be demonstrated and the requirements are sought. Elicitation and gathering of requirements for testing projects. Testing projects have become of late numerous, and the objectives of testing are to uncover all lurking defects, to certify a product as defect-free, virus-free or malware-free and so on, to benchmark a product vis-a-vis other comparable products, to accept software from a vendor and start using it. It could be any or a combination of these, or there may be some other objectives that I may not perhaps know. And the testing that is carried out concurrently while developing the software is normally referred to as embedded testing. A person codes a program and it is immediately tested. That is embedded testing. The testing carried out at the end of a software development project or on the final product is normally referred to as product testing. Embedded testing is carried out by the organization which is developing the software. Product testing can be and sometimes outsourced. Testing projects carry out this kind of testing. And testing project includes stress testing, load testing, parallel testing, concurrent testing, end-to-end testing, negative testing, in-situ testing, functional testing, positive testing. There are any number of tests. I have once documented, counted 32 varieties of tests being performed. Not necessarily all of them on every product, some of them depending on the requirement. What are the requirements needed for a testing product? The types of tests to be conducted as part of the testing project. How many tests do we include? What tests do we carry out? This is first requirement. Second, information for planning the specified tests. Information for designing the test cases. Information for pass-fail criteria or decisions. Process for ensuring the quality of the testing process itself. The testing process also should be have built-in quality, otherwise the testing itself will be a sham. Defect reporting and fixing strategy, regression testing strategy, constraints of time, budget and so on, progress reporting mechanisms. All these information is required before we start a testing project. Here, we are not using the requirement to build the product, but to ensure that quality is built into the product. And here, both elicitation and gathering techniques are used in the testing projects for requirements. Now, how do we test it? To design the test cases, they may give us a design document, a requirements document, and we will have to do that. Or sometimes, pass-fail criteria, or defect fixing strategy, or progress reporting mechanism, these we may have to elicit. And then the other type of project is software maintenance projects. In software maintenance projects, software is developed by somebody and it can be maintained by the same team, in which case there is requirements are not necessary. Oftentimes, the development team moves on to the other project and some other team will maintain the software. It may be internal or external. And in the software maintenance project, usually a maintenance work request triggers the maintenance work. You know, the nomenclature or the name I used, maintenance work request, can be called in any number, in any manner, by any other name. Program conversion request, program change request, software change request, whatever, design modification request, design concession request, they may call it by any name. I've seen 5-6 names being used in the industry. I'm using it just to connote the work request. It may be a work order also. It contains normally the problem description, which for the user, which form the user requirements. The team that attends to the request studies the issue and elicits further information if required. They also gather further information from studying the code and other documents like the design documents, test logs, and so on. Both elicitation and gathering techniques are used. Real-time software products. Real-time software is machine control, hardware control, real-time embedded firmware. software that controls the hardware, have stringent control on usage of resources, RAM, CPU, storage, times, response times. All these are critical. They have to be adhered to. We cannot have unlimited resources. Response time is extremely critical. Gathering assumes more significant than elicitation. Here we will have to study manuals, product manuals, hardware manuals, and then understand things. Of course, if there is an expert, we can elicit, but most of the times we cannot rely on oral information. We will have to rely on published information, verified information. Now, sometimes I heard this question being put to me, even to me when I conducted a workshop or two, should we use elicitation and gathering? I would say it is not elicitation or gathering. I would have to say it is elicitation and gathering. Both are important for requirements establishment, capturing of the requirements. Deliverables. What are the deliverables of elicitation and gathering? Notes taken during the interviews, responses to questionnaires administered personally, responses to questionnaires administered using postal method. Postal means it can be even email. Responses to surveys, formats and templates used in performing the business processes obtained from executives performing those processes. These would also contain all the data items used in the performing of the process. Information culled from studying organizational records, organizational process documentation, standards and guidelines, flowcharts of process steps, lists of inputs, outputs and associative processes performed in the organization for the proposed software development, information notes on how the inputs are converted into outputs, analysis to be carried out on the stored data for preparing the management information, details of required reports for the senior management of the organization, and many other things that I may not have listed here but are called for by the situation at hand. What are the pitfalls? Untrained personnel being used as business analysts or systems analysts. This is a common malady. Bringing in consideration of software design while capturing project requirements. When we are capturing work requirements, we should not keep the design aspect in our mind. That comes later. But first of all, capture all the requirements. When capturing the requirements, if we come to the conclusion that this is not possible to be met, we will not even capture. So we should keep this away. Bringing in the considerations of time and budgetary concern during the process of elicitation and gathering of requirements, especially applicable in in-house projects. For this, at this phase, we don't have this in our scope. That should not be the way. We should capture all the requirements since we are capturing, and some of them we may postpone later in consultation with the management. And unfortunately, not preparing well when beginning personal interviews. We should not go unprepared. We should spend time, sufficient time. Prejudices are human, and they cannot be eliminated, and they do come into the play and affect the process of capturing requirements and establishing quality requirements. Omitting the capture of vital process steps and data items in their completeness. The people performing the process takes many steps for granted. They bundle 5 or 6 steps into one single step. Then we will have to, the person who is eliciting needs to unbundle them by putting pointed questions and appropriate questions in a polite manner. And so thanks, friends. Thank you for watching. And please feel free to contact me at any time. And if possible, and if you think you are getting value for your time, please subscribe to my channel. Thank you.